my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts. Be acceptable in thy sight, you who are a rock and our redeemer. Amen. Take a moment and think about all the sounds that you hear in a day. The voices, the noise. Maybe you get to start your day off and just kind of slowly wake up at your own pace when you hear the birds chirping outside. Or maybe you have an alarm that you need to have set really loud that jars you awake because you need to get someplace. Maybe you get to hear the sound of the coffee percolating and dripping down into its craft. Maybe you hear that train whistle. I always seem to hear it somewhere around 2 or 3 in the morning. It carries that far up the hill. What noises do you hear during the day? Do you turn the news on early and start to get caught up in what's happening in the world? And sometimes I wonder, you know, why do I turn on the news quite so often, especially when 90% of it is our politicians who right now just seem to be yammering at each other, more screaming, it seems, than any words that are terribly productive. And so sometimes I wonder, why do I open myself up to have those voices be heard so much in my life? It's almost a little bit of an obsession or addiction to say, just how outrageous has somebody gotten now? What about the voices you choose to hear in a given day? Maybe you decide to call a family member or a friend because you just want to hear their voice. Or maybe you get stuck hearing the dogs barking. Dogs that aren't your own, and so their bark's not so loving, and they just seem yappy and obnoxious next door. Some noises make us frightened because we hear something drop or shatter, or maybe we hear someone fall, and it's certainly a noise we don't want to hear. There's all these noises, all these voices that come to us during the day, and some we choose, like maybe some beautiful music, and so many that we don't choose. Some that we turn on and we wonder, why in the world are we listening to this? That's the challenge. In the midst of all the voices that are out there, how do we hear Christ's voice? Jesus is having this interchange and they ask him, you know, tell us, who are you? You know, tell us plainly. And Jesus is almost saying, haven't you heard it yet? Haven't you heard through how I live and what I've been doing, how I've cared for the poor and reached out to the outcast? Haven't you heard in the actions that I have done who I am? And then Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice. But it's such a challenge to hear Christ's voice in the midst of all the noise of our lives. This afternoon, I get to spend a little bit of time with our junior and senior high youth in the wider area program down at First Church, and I'm asked to share some things about what it was like for me in junior high or high school. And I've been thinking about that a little bit, and especially in light of this passage about hear Christ's voice, and how during those years, it was kind of hard to hear Christ's voice. I mean, I was very active in church life and active in youth group and active in worship, but there was a lot of competing voices. My older brothers and sisters, they were 6, 10, and 12 years older than me, and, you know, this was the 70s going into the early 80s, and so, you know, they thought it'd be really good to let their little sister in on, you know, what it's like to smoke marijuana and pot. You know, and so there was kind of that voice in my life, and I was kind of like, you know, I just don't think this is quite me. But then in high school, I liked being social and having fun with my classmates. And, you know, in the town I grew up in, that often meant that, you know, Friday night you went to the football game or the basketball game, and at least during football season, I was in the marching band. And when you were old enough, which probably just meant age 15 or 16, you went to the after parties, which meant keg parties. And there was that sense in which that was kind of the definition of what it meant to have fun, what it meant to be part of the in crowd and to be accepted. And there was that voice that said, yeah, this is what you need to be about, and this is fun, and this is a good way to spend your time. And I have to admit it didn't take till probably my freshman, sophomore year of college that I realized that voice did not match very well with the voice of my faith. And I wish I could say I came to that realization because I spent quiet time praying and prayer and meditation, that I had a singing bowl that helped me, but I didn't even know what a singing bowl was back then. That was a time when, in order for me to hear Christ's voice, it had to break through all the other clatter and noise and voices out there saying, this is what you need to do, this is what you need to be about, this is who you need to be. How do we hear Christ's voice in the midst of all that clatter, all of that noise? Sometimes we think we need to listen to Christ's voice and that it will come to us, that God will actually speak to us. And I've talked to many people who will ask me, how do I hear what God needs to say to me? Why don't I hear God's voice? Or why doesn't Jesus speak to me when I ask questions and spend time in prayer? Sometimes we're looking for a real physical voice from God and think that is the only way to hear Christ's voice. But perhaps there's other ways to hear. I want you to think for a minute about dancing. Now, when you think about dancing, you automatically think about the music you're going to dance to. And the music kind of tells you what your dance will be like. If it's a nice slow waltz, you might dance romantically with somebody. Or if it's fast-paced music, you might dance in a different way. And we always associate dancing with hearing and listening to music. But maybe there's another way to hear music and to actually dance. I will confess that I am a follower of Dancing with the Stars. We seem to frequently have Monday meetings in here, and when I get home from my Monday meeting, I start my recording of Dancing with the Stars and wind down. And this particular season, there's a gentleman, he's actually a model, and he's deaf. And then the family he grew up in, he had many within this family that were deaf, and they have learned to use sign language together, and it's a very comfortable world for him. And so to see him dance without that assumption that he has to hear the music is rather unique. And so take a moment and see what it's like to dance when you hear in a different way. He doesn't hear the beat of the music. He He even admits that there really isn't a whole lot of vibration that he feels. He doesn't hear the roar of the crowd egging him on. He doesn't feel the pulse of the music. And yet we know that he's hearing in a different way. Here's how we always experience his dancing and the music.
I ain't too sure what I believe in, but I believe in what I see. And when I close my eyes, I see my whole life ahead of me.
These are arms out on the verge, out on the verge of the rest of our lives.
In the quiet of his world, he manages to hear. He manages to hear music. He manages to find a beat. He manages to find a rhythm. He hears in a different way. How do we hear? How do we hear Christ's voice in the midst of the clamor? How do we hear Christ's voice when we're in the midst of turmoil and struggle and wondering what direction to go next? As I've been thinking about this theme of hearing Christ's voice, hearing God's voice, I've thought about Elijah. Elijah went through a time where he was running from Jezebel. Jezebel was wreaking havoc. All of Israel was in turmoil, and Elijah just didn't know what to do. And so he began running for his life from Jezebel, and he got to a point when he just thought, you know, I can't win this. She's going to get me. Something's going to get me. And he decides it'd be just better off if he died. And so he's there kind of wallowing in his situation, and the first voice he hears is from an angel that tells him to get up and eat, and happened to provide a cake on the hot stones for him to eat. And then he's still kind of perplexed, and the angel one more time says, get up and eat, otherwise you won't have enough for the journey ahead of you. And Elijah's still kind of confused, even though he does as the angel says, and he's still wondering what to do next. And the angel tells him to go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. And you can imagine that Elijah's like, oh good, the Lord is going to come by. I'm going to get some answers now. I'm going to hear something from God. And here's how the story goes. Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, and remember, when Elijah heard the sound of sheer silence, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave, and the voice of the Lord came to him. That sense in which God comes to us in the sheer silence. And the challenge is, how do we get ourselves to that place of hearing the sheer silence? How do we find those times and places and spaces where we can clear the clutter of our minds, where we can set aside the to-do list, where we can stop replaying that tape of what we ought to have done differently or could have done differently, or how do I make this situation turn out the way I want it to. Those times we just wrap our heads around situations we can't control, but we can't seem to let go of it. How do we find that space of sheer silence so that rather than trying to maybe hear with our ears, we hear with our hearts? Maybe about listening for Christ's voice is about being heart listeners. Let me share with you this prayer for listening. My Creator, my desire is for my spirit to hear your spirit. I pray for listening ears, eyes, heart, mind, and soul. Throughout each day, help me to listen to the sacred around me, to rest in your calm and to move in your urging. Remind me that you are always near, that your overwhelming love for me and for all of your creation provides the true meaning for what life is all about. As your love fills my being, I pray for courage to share that love with others. My soul is comforted and healed by your grace. Help me remember to listen. To pray for listening ears, a listening heart, a listening soul. How do you hear Christ's voice? Does Christ have to break in over the clamor of your life, over the noise? Does Christ's voice have to break through all the others who are telling you who you ought to be and what you ought to do? Or do you find some quiet times where Christ's voice comes through the running of water, the sound of the birds, the quiet of your own heartbeat? Hearing Christ's voice. Jesus says, "You will hear my voice." And sometimes it'll be a voice that comforts, sometimes a voice that challenges, but always a voice that says, "You are my beloved. You are my sons, my daughters. With you I am well pleased." May we be ones who hear with our hearts. Amen.